Ladies and gentlemen, the Board of Directors, Executive Director, and staff of the Ohio High School Athletic Association, along with the Board of Education and Administration of Jackson City Schools, extend to each of you a cordial welcome to this OHSAA tournament event. Tonight's matchup is the Division III Regional Second Round game between the visiting team, Eastmore Academy High School, and the Warriors, and the home team, the Jackson High School, Ironmen. This tournament is sponsored and conducted by the Ohio High School Athletic Association for its member schools in order to make this contest as enjoyable as possible. Please represent your school and your community in a positive and respectful manner. That includes showing courtesy and respect for your fellow fans, officials, coaches, administrators, and authority figures, and of course, your team and opponent. Let's make this a great contest and great to be remembered by respecting the game. Your coach for the Eastmore Academy Warriors is James Miranda. Head coach for the Ironmen is Andy Hall. If you would please direct your attention to the 50-yard line where the captains have joined your officials for tonight for the coin toss. Eastmore has won the toss and deferred to the second half. The Ironmen will receive the ball to start the first half. Eastmore will defend the south end zone. Your officials for tonight's game have been selected and assigned according to the OHSAA Board of Directors adopted procedures, which includes the involvement of coaches and the athletic administrators from member schools. The officials for tonight are referee David Sparks, umpire Douglas Gauze, head linesman Brandon Abbott, line judge Keith Causey, back judge Truman Hash, and center judge Gerald Peters. Ladies and gentlemen, if you love sports and have a desire to stay close to the game and you want to contribute to the educational experiences of student athletes, you're encouraged to become an OHSAA contest official where open positions are always available. To get started, go to OHSAA.org/officiating today.
Our opponents.
As fellow athletes and worthy competitors.
Like us, we
talked about this in the pregame show last
week. We will respect our teammates. We will respect everyone's efforts because each one makes a contribution to the team in his or her own way.
We will respect our coaches for their efforts in molding the teams that represent our school.
We will respect the officials for enforcing the rules of the game and keeping the game fair for all participants. We will respect ourselves as athletes. We are role models.
How we conduct ourselves in school,
during competition, and in the community
is a reflection on us, our families, and our school. So we ask all fans in attendance
to encourage and cheer for your team.
Let the players play.
Let the coaches coach. Let the officials officiate.
And let the spectators be positive.
Respect the game. Respect the game.
Respect the game.
Respect the game.
Championship all cut touchdown passes, but the most impressive finish was the finish of the half, a 5-play, 47-yard drive with one timeout left to set up Ethan Crabtree for a 42-yard field goal.
Yeah, you know, we work every Thursday on a 2-minute drive and work a situation where, you know, maybe we don't score, but we kick a, you know, a field goal right before half, and it worked out perfectly to where we were able to get to him in field goal position. Again, 42 yards with a lot of leg left, and it was a great way to end the half, and you know, it really gave momentum for us to get into the second half. You know, we were able to take the opening kickoff, got great field position, home blankship had another nice return, and then we're able to score to, you know, make it 30-0, which, you know, put it at a running clock. Was able to get some young kids in there in that second half, and you know, like you said, you know, playoff situation, those you know, games don't happen very often, but you know, I think we played with a lot of intensity. We were very physical at the point of attack, and I think maybe even surprised those guys a little bit about how physical we could be. And you know, it's just, again, kids played well, coaching staff, great game plans, and it all came together last week in a great win.
Well, the second half, you just mentioned a little bit about it, but we started out with a 72-yard drive quickly and hit Brody Butcher on a long touchdown pass. And then we ate up most of the whole third quarter with a 9-play, 72-yard drive to finish up the third quarter and basically game in our side.
Right. You know, the Butcher touchdown was off play action, and he was wide open, and Jacob made a great throw, and Brody made a guy miss and really turned on the Jets. I think surprised people, and he could really, you know, he really ran, and you know, it was really great to see him. He does all the dirty work blocking and so forth, and but you know, the times he's caught the football, he's you know, he's scored either touchdowns or had some great, you know, some big plays. But and like I said, at the end of the third quarter, we were able to just grind the ball out, get back to our running game, run a lot of counter tray and fullback trap, and you know, Cade Wolford really had some really nice runs there in that third quarter. And Eli Berman at fullback, broke a couple of nice trap plays. And so we were able to put some points on the board in the running game. And in the fourth quarter, you know, play a lot of our young kids and get out pretty healthy. And like I said, with the win, so it was a good night.
Stats in our favor, first downs were 20-9, total yards 390 yards for the Ironman, 99 total yards we held them to defensively. The big stat of the game, let's go with rushing first, 193 yards rushing for us to 99 for them. Passing, 197 yards for the Ironman, 4 touchdowns included in that, 0 passing yards for Columbus South. They have no chance to win a game with those kind of stats.
You're right, and we knew that, you know, they were a run-first football team, but that when they got to a point where they had to throw the football, you know, our secondary was just all over their guys. We were able to put some pressure on the quarterback, had a few sacks. You know, Ty Jones and A.J. Denny, those guys were in the backfield almost all night, and you know, put a lot of heat on him where he was uncomfortable, and like I said, didn't give up a completion. You know, when you can do that, then you're gonna, you know, do a, you know, you're gonna hold these guys to very few, you know, yards and points. So again, kudos to our defense and how they played, and you know, that's the same type of effort and relentless pressure we're gonna have to put on these guys tonight.
Well, it's just what I was going to say, our defense now. We got to go over, after all those offensive stats and numbers, defense was unbelievable for the second week in a row. Two back-to-back shutouts. And this was a team that had averaged 45 points a game, and we held their big running back Ford and their quarterback Simmons. We kept them under 100 yards total offense. Boy, the defense has been outstanding.
It has, and realistically, it's been that way all year. And you look at our stats and what we've been able to give up against some quality opponents. You know, we're averaging, giving up just, you know, I think 12 or 13 points a game for the season, right at about 200 yards. So, you know, it's a situation where, you know, the kids understand watching film where things are going to happen. We have a lot of kids that are athletic enough to get to the football. We play with a lot of, you know, kids that are not very big, but they can run, and they're a great.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, under the direction of Brian Hurd with assistant directors Sam Poodle and Mary Elizabeth Billman, percussion instructor Keith Wilson, auxiliary instructors Tiffany Bertrand and Elizabeth Mannering, and professional interns Ms. Katie King and Mr. Nathan Clemens, we proudly present to you the 2021 edition of the Pride of Jackson, the Jackson High School Marching Ironmen. Please rise for the playing of the Jackson High School alma mater, conducted tonight by Assistant Director Mr. Sam Poodle. Ladies and gentlemen, this season the Marching Ironmen have been recognizing a different branch of the armed forces at each home game. Tonight we're asking all current and veteran members of the United States Air Force to stand and be recognized as the band plays your service song, the Air Force song. Now, ladies and gentlemen, will you please stand and remove your hats for the playing and singing of the Star Spangled Banner, conducted tonight by Director of Bands, Mr. Ryan Hurd. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to remind you again tonight that there are restrooms and concession stands on both sides of the field, the visitor's side and the home side. The visitor's side concession stand is run by the Football Mothers Club, and the home side concession stand is run by the Jackson Band Boosters. Plenty of great food and snacks on both sides. make sure you support both organizations, and let's enjoy a great night of high school football action. Again, Columbus Eastmore did win the toss, and they chose to defer for the second half. Ironman will receive the football to start the game.
It will be taken at the 11-yard line, right side of the field. Comes to the middle. Now breaks it to the outside with a lane. 35, 40. Penalty flag comes in as Holden Blankenship returns it out near midfield. But the airman going to get caught with the hold.
Yeah, really a nice job by Holden. Took it right up the middle, then broke it to the outside right here on the home field side. And he turned the corner, and there is going to be a hold. It's going to be about the 40-yard line. So the airman won't be in terrible field position, but Holden had taken it past the 15 was going to give us a nice short field on our first possession.
Holding
is
the ball. First down.
Makes the line of scrimmage the 30. They're going to place it right outside the 30-yard line, Pete.
Let's get that ever-improving offensive line named Caleb McGraw, the senior, the only senior in that big group in there. The two guards, David Norris and Nate O'Brien, and then the two tackles, Trent Evans and Tyler Messer. Tight end will be Brody Butcher. Go, Pete.
Blankenship gets credit, though, for a 29-yard kickoff return. Of course, they lost 10 yards on the penalty. Still a decent field position at their own 30 as we start this game.
First and 10, Ford, and now we have a whistle stopping the play.
Somebody, number three now, is leaving the field. Wonder if that was an equipment issue. It had to be. He's being replaced in there, so the officials were the one that stopped play. We'll get him over there on the sideline and probably get that corrected one way, shape, or form.
Okay, they're from the left hash mark. First and 10 for the Jackson Army Hut. And tonight's first possession. Trips out wide to the right side. The winner, say, hands off right up the middle. And that was that Kate?
Nope, that was Browerman.
Browerman gets back to the line of scrimmage, maybe a half a yard, but not much to go with there for the Ironman on first and 10.
Going to give him maybe 1 yard in there. Ironman going with the wide out there, so you have Jake Wood in there in the lineup. You put Cade Wolford out there also wide out. Tristan Prater to wind up. The only back in the backfield was Eli Browerman. Jacob Winters under the center.
Now the Ironman go out of the I formation. Here's handoff. It's Cade Wolford with the carry. He picks up the first down, a gain of 13, and Ironman moving out to the 43-yard line.
Right up the gut, that offensive line, as we mentioned, McGraw, Norris, O'Brien. Good hole in there for Cade. It was nothing but right behind the right guard and center, and he was able to take it out to the 43-yard line. A quick first down for Jackson.
Still on the left hash mark. Prater here, the near side of the field, now out of the shotgun. Winters wants to pass, looking, flares it out in the flat, and tended for Holden Blankenship. That pass a little high and falls incomplete.
I think they'll take a peek at that because they just streaked Jake Wood down the sideline, and then they were going to throw it out to Holden in the flats, and Jake ran right by his cornerback there and actually had a little room there. Coaches up top will take note on that.
This time the on second and 10. Slot to the left side, backs in the eye, and here's Winters. Hand off to Wolfer coming left. He is met at the 47-yard line, picks up about four on that first down carry, tackled right here in front of Coach Hall.
Jake Wolfer's rushing the football has improved so much as the year has worn on. Looks so much more confident there. He's approaching 900 yards on this season. He's been our touchdown maker, 16 overall, I think 9 rushing, 7 catching the football.
Give him a gain of about 4.5, so it's third down and a long 5 for the Ironmen. Ball at their own 47-yard line. And here's a pitch out to Wolford, trying to get the corner on the right side. Looking, crosses midfield, and does a nice job of picking up the first down.
Well, it's a little different formation. Coach Hall hinted on that. Might be like a double slot formation there, very tight. They just bring Cade in motion. They pitch to him, and it becomes a sweep. Cade made 4 or 5 yards, then he got hit, and then he did a great job of falling forward and picking up that first down yardage.
And the moves the ball into Eastmore territory at their 47-yard line. Now the airman on the opposite side of the field, first and 10. Max in the eye, and here's Winters handing off to Wolford, and not much room there. The airman on first down, be back to the line of scrimmage for second and 10 coming up.
Some big bodies in there for Eastmore, and they stood strong there, but one of their smaller defenders, Jamar Carter, made that play. He's 5'6", 170, but there's some strong big bodies, as Coach Hall has said. They got huge people in there, and they've got good team speed. They average scoring about 35 points a game.
All right, second and 10 for the airman. Send a man in motion, now coming on a jet sweep around the left end is Holden Blankenship, and he crosses the 45 down to about the 43-yard line. We're to ring up third down, and let's give it a call at about 6.
Making Eastmore go east and west so far, getting to the outside, having a little success. A 3rd and 6 situation, and right now, do you consider the fact we're probably in 2-down territory?
3rd down and 6 at the 43-yard line of Eastmore. And snap back to Winters. Pressure from the backside. Now he'll take off and run. Has some room and slides down. He'll be short of the first down at the 39-yard line. So it'll bring up 4th down and about 2.
Picked up positive yards, though. So I think he takes the question out of whether you punt or not going out of it. 4th and 2. Ball inside the 40-yard line of Eastmore. The Ironmen are going to play for it.
Jackson, or Eastmore, did win the toss. They elected to defer to the second half, so that's why the Ironmen have this football to start the opening drive of the game.
So important, too, if you can take that opening drive and score, then you do, the fact that you lost the toss becomes our favor anyway.
All right, 4th and 2 at the 39-yard line.
Double slot formation again.
Wolfer goes in motion. He gets the pitch, trying to get the corner. Gives a stiff arm and dives for the first down marker, and I don't believe he got it. It will be close.
Eastmore coaching staff is convinced he didn't get it, tried to get to the outside, actually took it all the way out to the out-of-bounds line, but it's going to come up a good yard short, and Eastmore's going to hold us on downs after we put a couple good first downs together.
7:53 remaining first quarter. We have no score.
Difference there, we weren't successful on first down.
No,
and
that's right.
Put us in tough situation each time, but we were able to overcome it till that last one, Pete.
All right, Jackson did get 2 first downs, stayed on the ground the whole time except for one incomplete pass, but Eastmore takes over at their 38-yard line.
Quarterback is Devin Lloyd, number 4. He works out of the shotgun. Takes a snap and hands off and hit in the backfield and dropped for a loss. All the way back to the 35-yard line. Boy, the Ironman defense was right there on top of that one.
Well, we have bragged about our outside linebackers. Xander Karagosian set a tone right there. He came hard from his outside linebacker position and really put a hit, and that turns out to be a 3-yard loss on the play. And Xander, along with Drew Bragg, have been outstanding at those spots out there. Ty Jones, the senior starting nose guard, also in there.
We'll get the tackles. They fluctuate quite a bit in there.
Second and 13 for the Warriors. Motion from left to right. Now Fish will stop the clock or stop the play as the penalty flag was thrown. They're going to be penalized for illegal procedure.
A.J. Denny in there, one in the tackle position. Caleb McGraw at the other. As we said, we'll go in and out of there. Grant Matson starting at the inside linebacker position. And Brody Butcher, the other. Cornerbacks Holden Blankenship and Tristan Prater. And I think it's holding out there. We'll also see an awful lot of Bo Landrum at the cornerback position. Cade Wolford and Eli Berman, the two safeties.
It's a second down and 18 after the five-yard penalty. 7:02 remaining in this first quarter. We have no score.
It is Bo Landrum starting out there at that cornerback position.
Lloyd is in that quarterback. Now he comes out in the slot formation as number two. Ahmad Armstrong goes will pass, and here's a pitch out to number one, Sally. Sally has, he is caught from behind by Tristan Prater, and nice open field tackle there.
Great tackle, because that play was set up nicely, a little bubble screen, and they got the first flag, Brock, and he was able to cut to the outside, and boy, Tristan got him by the shoestrings and brought him down what could have been a big play. Now they're faced with a third and 11.
And the ball at the 37-yard line.
Crowd getting involved, nice crowd on hand on the Jackson sideline. I would call that a sparse crowd from Eastmore.
That's being kind.
I thought so.
Okay. Third down and 11 for Eastmore. They work out of the shotgun from the right hash mark. And the snap back. Looking left, and going deep down the field. The ball will be incomplete at the 20-yard line.
Boy, he had time back there, and that allowed a receiver to kind of break behind our defense, but he overthrows him, goes incomplete, yes.
Matthew Washington, number six, like you said, had the defender beat by a couple of steps, but now we'll bring up fourth down and 11.
Yep.
5:53 to go, first quarter. The Airmen failed to convert on a fourth down. So they turn the ball back over to Eastmore. Now Eastmore on their first possession.
They couldn't overcome a penalty, and so they are going to have to punt on their first three snaps.
Snap is a bad one, and the ball will be bouncing as the punter does get it away. It takes a Eastmore roll, and it's going to be down at the 26-yard line as a marker comes in.
Really a bad snap, and the punter did a fabulous job of fielding that like a shortstop, had a defender right in his face, and somehow got a line drive kickoff and got a great roll on it. Yeah. And then a flag came late because I don't think when it's a bad snap like that.
It's going to be a sideline warning.
Sideline warning, okay. We were so close to getting a block, which how many block punts have we had this season? A handful of them.
Pete Wilson, the punter short off the snap back a couple of plays, but he doesn't get it off.
Gets a 37-yard punt out of it. It could have been a disaster for Eastmore, but instead, a decent punt.
And Winters takes over as the Ironman offense, and Winters on a keeper. Start from the 27-yard line, across the 30, maybe to the 31. So gain about three, maybe 3.5 yards.
Jacob has shown he's not been scared to tuck it in a little bit and run the football. It gives you another back in the backfield when your quarterback can do that. Picks up 4 yards there on first down.
Prater would go to the right side as the Ironman break the huddle. Backs were split. And quick handoff up the middle over the right side to Broerman. He puts his head down and then slides off the ball to the right side, and he may be close to another first down for the Ironman.
Good blocking at the point of attack. Gave Eli some room there. They moved the markers. They give the Ironman another first down. Ironman coming out really dedicated to running the football. And let's be honest, what have we lived and died with? It's been throwing the ball this year. 4 touchdown passes last week. 26 on the season for this Jackson team.
Rapidly moving first quarter. 4:44 remaining. Here's a snap and handoff. Sure, is that Broerman? Yes, it was.
It was Broerman running the ball. I was just watching Coach Hall getting Jacob Winters over on the sideline and giving him some information there.
Okay, it's a gain of 2 for the Airmen. Ball rests at the 40-yard line.
there might be some confusion in the airman huddle now as they still have 15 seconds on the play clock. They break the huddle, Wood out wide to the right side. Blankenship and Wolford in also to the right. And there's a quick pitch out to Broman.
Great blocks.
Trying to get around. Good job by Eastmore defending that little bubble pass out to Broman, and it's going to be a minimal gain of to bring up third and seven.
It looked like at first we all three got a block out there, and it might be a big play, and Eastmore shed off those blocks nicely and only kept it to a one-yard gain. So the airmen facing another third and relatively long third and seven situation.
Ball at their own 41-yard line.
3:31 to go in a scoreless first quarter. Ironman's second possession, each Eastmore with only one so far.
And the right hash mark here is taking the snap, looking left, and he throws it, and it's going to be caught by Jake Wood, and he is tackled immediately. Maybe a loss of one. Where he comes, it will still be a loss of one on the completed pass to Jake Wood.
Eastmore secondary looks very athletic, and they had that play well read, and the Ironmen are going to be forced to punt now after one first down.
That means Tristan Prater will stand in punting formation.
Prater with the unbelievable record of punting for 2 years and not having a punt returned. Let's see if that stays intact.
Okay. Two return people back for Eastmore standing at the 33-yard line. Low snap for Prater. Now he gets it away, and it's going to be a...
Could be a great
good
kick.
Whoa. It's picked up at the 20-yard line, and then up the middle of the field, and now breaking outside with some running room down the far sideline and tackled. Like
Caleb McGraw, superb effort there, chasing him down. He was just about to cut it up the middle, then took it over to the visiting sideline. And if he could have got past Caleb, he might have been still running down that sideline. But it was a good kick, good return, and they did return run on him, Pete.
Finally, and it took a good play because the returner Contip had to kind of pick it up off his back shoulder while he was going the wrong direction, but he did, and he got a 17-yard return.
All right,
to the 40-yard line of Eastmore.
They will start at their own 40-yard line. No score here with just 2 minutes and 27 seconds remaining in the first quarter. Movement along the line of scrimmage as Warriors send two men in motion, and now another one, and now a timeout has been called by Eastmore. And we'll do the same, a break in the action here at Alumni Stadium where your score is 0-0, and we'll be back right after this timeout.
When you think of your community bank, are you thinking of leading technology? Things like mobile banking and mobile deposit, being able to pay a friend using Zelle. Are you thinking of best-in-class bill pay and customized account alerts? If you're thinking of those things, then you must be thinking of Jackson County Banking Center. They have leading technology and local support. And by local, we mean right here in your neighborhood. Leading technology, local support. That's Jackson County Banking Center. Member FDIC.
You're listening to Jackson High School Sports on the all-new Mix 96 FM. And now, back to the action.
2:27 remains in the first quarter of play here. Week number 12, Jackson versus Columbus Eastmore, and it's 0-0 after Warriors looking at a first down and 10 from their own 40.
Feels like a boxing match where both fighters are kind of feeling each other out at this moment, seeing what they can and can't do against each other. Jackson obviously has come out with the philosophy, we want to run the football. Eastmore, the same thing. I think they live more on the run than they do the pass.
Well, Devin Lloyd is the quarterback, and now they shift, and Lloyd comes into the slot as number two, Ahmad Armstrong, takes over. And here's a handoff, and starting over right side is number seven, that's Marvavius Hampton. And Hampton picks up about nine on the play.
Ty Jones brings him down, but not until about an 8 or 9 yard gain, and that gets them out very near midfield and an opportunity to pick up their first down in this contest, second and one.
Eastmore breaks the huddle. They send Washington out wide to the left side, and here on the near side of the field is Presley. With Lloyd back in at quarterback, takes the low snap, bobbles it, and he'll go down
He's still on his feet, but now he'll go down. A loss of 9 on the play, all the way back to the 40-yard line.
Commander Karagosian wraps him up. A lot of Ironmen in there pressuring him after the bad snap. But boy, that's a big tackle for a loss again for the senior outside linebacker. That sure takes that advantage of a 2nd and 1. All of a sudden, now you're looking at 3rd and 8. Their center, just to get an idea of their size, is a mere, 275? Yeah, I said he came up over the ball. And he said, that's a big boy. Well, he is that, exactly.
3rd down and 8 for the Warriors. Snap back and looking to pass, looking over the middle. The ball will be tipped. And incomplete. Roerman had a hand on it, the only one to touch it, but it was high, and it falls incomplete.
Probably about 3 or 4 feet too high for the intended receiver. Ironman did get a touch on it, but really didn't have an opportunity for an interception, so it'll be another punting situation for Eastmore. They pick up 9 on the first snap, but that big tackle for a loss by Xander Karagosian sets up the punt.
Dixon, number 83, is the punter. The lone return player back for the Iron is Holden Blankenship. Had some trouble with the snap on the last punt attempt, and we'll see what the better snap, and Dixon gets it away, and it will be caught by Blankenship at the 29-yard line. Blankenship returns it out close to the 35, again at a return of 6 yards.
Ironman's third possession here so far, a scoreless game, and this first quarter is almost in the books. 52 seconds left, Pete.
A 30-yard punt there by Dixon. A good return by Blankenship as he gave the Ironmen 5 extra yards after that 30-yard punt. No, make it 6. They put it on the 34-yard line, and that's where Jackson will go back to business here with 52.7 seconds now left in this first quarter.
And a scoreless first quarter. It's Jacob Winters under center with backs behind him in a split, and now movement along the line. The Ironman going to be penalized for procedure.
It was obviously going to be a trap block. One of the Ironmen started their trap block about a second before everybody else, so they'll get backed up of 5 yards. One of the things Jacob has done so well the last few weeks is his cadence there, but that time he fooled his own team.
52 seconds remains in this scoreless first quarter. Jackson's third possession. They'll start with a 1st and 15 from their own 29-yard line. Slot to the left side, and quick handoff right up the middle with Blankenship breaking some tackles, or it's Broerman breaking a tackle, and gets the penalty yards back as he started over left tackle, broke it to the outside, and it's a 5-yard gain.
Broerman's made a good living running in between the guard center gaps in there for this year for the Ironman. He really hits that hole quickly. That time he did break a tackle and got us at least back in a 2nd and 10 situation.
All right, the Ironman with trips out to the right side. Snap back to Winters, looking, now throwing upfield, and it's going to be incomplete as the intended receiver, Cade Wolford, was around the 40-yard line, got one hand on it, but it falls incomplete, and that stops the clock with 13 seconds to go in this third quarter.
Throw a little high and wide. The Airmen rolling out. They've had some pretty good pressure on Jacob the few times we have looked to pass the ball. That time their defensive end was coming quickly in on him, so the Airmen are forced now to look at a 3rd and 10 situation. To be honest, neither team in this first quarter has had a lot of success offensively. Defense is looking strong.
Certainly have. Here's a 3rd and long. Here's the Winters in trouble. He eludes that now. Throws wide open to Wolfer at midfield. He eludes one tackle. He's at the 40. And tackled at the 38-yard line.
Fabulous play by Jacob Winters to stay alive in the pocket. They had pressure all over him. He turned and just stiff-armed one guy, kept his feet under him, and was able to buy enough time to find a wide-open Cade Wolford out there in the flats, and Cade then advances it with making a tackler miss.
And that's the end of the first quarter of play here at Jackson Alumni Stadium. Your score, Jackson 0, Eastmore 0. We'll be back right after this timeout.
Before, during, or after the game, Papa John's of Jackson has the deal for you. Order one of their delicious Epic Stuffed Crust pizzas, or try the new Shaqaroni pizza, and don't forget to add on a garlic parmesan papadilla. Order online at PapaJohns.com or download the Papa John's app to place your order and have it ready when you are. If you don't want to get out, order through DoorDash and have it delivered to you in Jackson, Wellston, or Colton. That's right, DoorDash delivery in Jackson, Wellston, or Colton, only at your local Papa John's of Jackson. You're listening to Jackson High School Sports on the all-new Mix 96 FM. And now, back to the action.
Welcome back to Jackson Ironman football. Dan Dawson, Pete Wilson, and Dan Moore. It's Columbus Eastmore 0, Jackson Ironman 0 after one quarter of play.
Great play by Jacob Winters. Pete Wilson, those points on the scoreboard, but boy, that was a pretty effort there.
Well, you know, that's one of the things you want your quarterback to be able to do, be able to improvise when the play breaks down, and Winters saw a wide open Cade Wilford. Kudos to Cade, though, for keeping the play alive and moving into position if Winters could get the ball to him, and he did. A 28-yard gain happened to be the biggest play for either team in that first quarter. Ironman had four first downs, none for Eastmore. Jackson with an edge in total yardage, 78-6.
Okay, and it's a first and 10 at the 38-yard line of Eastmore. Winters will hand the ball, or fake it to Blankenship. He'll come up the middle.
He has
into
some room.
The 30, 25, down to the 20-yard line. Inside the 15, still on the team. And run out of bounds at the 12-yard line.
Fake the jet sweep, and Jacob sets a threat back there to run the football. We mentioned earlier in that quarter, he's another running back back there. Broke it to the near sideline here. Got a good block by Jake Woods out there in the secondary, and he takes it all the way down. Where are they going to mark him? The 12-yard line?
First and 10, yes. In the red zone? Here come the Ironmen. Well, placed on the right hash mark as the Ironmen line up. Broman and Wolford in the backfield, and handoff will go to Broman. Eli does the Broman. Gets wrapped up and then spins out of that and gets down to about the 10-yard line. Gain of about 2 yards.
And looked like he had room there, didn't it? And I'll tell you, and Eli hit that hole quickly there, but give credit to Eastmore. Their defense is sound. They got there in a hurry, and they gang tackled and only kept us to a 2-yard gain.
Line of scrimmage is the 10-yard line. No score in this game by either team. The Ironmen, now after a couple big plays, have it second down and 10 or 8 at the 10-yard line. Motion by the Ironman. They fake it again, and this time it's Winters. He's wrapped up in the backfield, but does an excellent job of getting out of the tackle by Washington and back to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, good size in there, Matthew. Washington came in from, he's 6'3", 195. Good size athletes on this Eastmore team, and that's two big bodies with he and Jacob Winters there. Jacob falls forward and keeps us about the line of scrimmage. Quickly third and long now.
Yes, third. Scoreboard shows third and 9. Empty backfield. Here's a pass out in the flat to Broman, and he's upended in the backfield, spinning forward and tackled at the 10-yard line for no gain. And now the punter, the field goal unit, will come onto the game field for the Ironmen.
Very impressed with this secondary effort by Eastmore. They have been there quickly and covering our people. That time we got the ball out once again to Broderman in the flats there, but good pursuit, and they got him tied down at about the 10-yard line. So
from the 17, it'll be a 27-yard field goal from the right hash mark.
Just a chip shot for this sophomore.
Good hold by Wood. The kick on the way, and it is down the middle. The Ironmen take the lead, 3-0 with 9:35 remaining in this first half of play, and we'll be back after this timeout.
Dakota's Roadhouse is open at 451 McCarty Lane in Jackson. At Dakota's, we are committed to protecting the health and safety of our customers and employees. We would like to thank you for your continued support. We offer carryout, curbside pickup, and a spacious covered patio. For delicious steaks, ribs, burgers, seafood, and more, stop into Dakota's Roadhouse in Jackson.
True fans know that success in football is all about tradition, dedication, and loyalty. Those same qualities are important to the Sheward Faulks Insurance Agency. We care about what's important to you, and that's why we believe in helping you select the right insurance for your needs. We're proud to support companies like Ohio Mutual Insurance Group. If you want to protect your auto, home, farm, or business, you want Ohio Mutual on your team. Give us a call at 740-286-1708. We'd love to help evaluate your insurance needs and recommend the best coverage from the best companies, like Ohio Mutual. Go Ironman.
3-0, the Jackson Ironmen have the first score of tonight's football game as Ethan Crabtree connects on the 27-yard field goal, Pete.
7 plays, 56 yards is the drive. It stalls at the 10, but Crabtree makes it not wasted as he gets 3 points out of it on a true field goal from 27 yards. Big plays in the drive, the pass to Wolford of 28 yards, and the run by Winters of 26.
This is a short kickoff taken at the 20-yard line and returning it around the right side and trying to get a seam.
Ooh.
Cuts it back across the grain, then tackled at the 38-yard line.
Well, we keep saying his name, but Xander Karagosian makes that tackle, and I'll tell you what, that was a special teams tackle because that young man was making things look pretty exciting, and he might have been going a little bit farther if we don't make that tackle at that point.
Number 3, Muhammad Kuntis. Is his name.
How about Ethan Crabtree's 6th field goal on the season, and that one at halftime last week was set up beautifully, and Coach Hall and I talked about that, how with one timeout, how we dinked it down the field to get us in field goal position and him to kick it on the last play of the half, but he right now is the leading scorer in tonight's game with those 3 points up on the board, and we'll take it. Penalty, you're right, penalty, and it's going to march this team back on the kickoff return.
15-yard penalty, block in the back, and
maybe that's why he was open and so successful.
Lose the line of scrimmage all the way back to the 16-yard line. So rather than starting at the 40 or near the 40, Eastmore will start deep in their own territory.
Well, this defense that has pitched 2 straight shutouts is off to a flying start again tonight.
Evan Lloyd will start at quarterback, kind of in a pistol formation. Now he moves out of that, and
they've got about 5 quarterbacks. I think anybody in the backfield can play it.
It's a snap back to... There's a handoff is to Hampton, but I saw Armstrong, who stepped in at quarterback, handing off to him.
Grant Maston with the tackle, but they were able to get some positive yards there. Matter of fact, make that about a 7-yard run on first down. Yet to get a first down in this game, Eastmore. Ironman defense has really been stingy.
That's 2nd and 3 from their 23-yard line.
They have had a couple costly penalties.
Interesting team as they have several players that have interchanged at quarterback. They line up as if one is wanting to take the snap and then switch it up. Here's a low snap, and it's picked up by the quarterback and handed off to Contis. And Contis, he's going to be stopped short of the first down at the 25-yard line.
Tucker Williams in there for the Ironmen defensively, playing with a strong safety position. It's going to be a 3rd and a long one as they get the ball to the 25-yard line. We'll see if Eastmore can get their first down.
Jackson leads 3-0 on a Ethan Crabtree field goal, and that's been it. 6 or 8 minutes and 30 seconds remaining in the second quarter. Eastmore, 3rd down. And off, and I think he's going to have the first down after the 32-yard line.
They got him marked with it, so it should be their first down. Ironman made him work for it. Pick up 2 when they needed 1. Guys, we're already just 8 minutes, 11 seconds to go in the first half, and quick moving first half because nobody's had any real success throwing the football except the one broken play, Winters to Wolford.
And now it's 1st and 10 for the Warriors of Eastmore. They slot to the left side and snap back and then a handoff. Whoa, the Ironmen are right there to pick up Muhammad Kuntis. He is nailed for a... They're going to give him forward progress back to the line of scrimmage.
The Monroe Collision Hit of the Week award winner last week just put on a display. That was a perfect nose-to-nose tackle there, and he drove the person back beautifully. Grant Maston, it's the way linebackers are supposed to play.
It'll be a gain of a half a yard or so, and it'll...
I think Grant remembers or knows who Dick Butkus is, but that looked Dick Butkus style. We old guys do.
There's a penalty flag thrown in on this 2nd down and 9. It was a juggle of the football, but Eastmore.
Brody Butcher in there on the bottom of the pile, along with A.J. Denny. Flag comes down. Eastmore has been struggling with penalties, but I think... Drew Bragg's reaction, I'm just getting, he overheard the official that it might be against Jackson.
just reading his body language.
Exactly.
Oh, second sideline warning, so that is going to be a 5-yard penalty.
And now another penalty against the Ironman sideline.
That one will be a bigger penalty.
Yes, it will be.
Obviously, the coaches on our sideline not happy with a second sideline warning.
And the first penalty is assessed, and now we'll have, this will be a 15-yarder.
Coach Hall trying to get a discussion with that line judge, but not having much success there, and the other official kind of talking to him, but that is a penalty that puts Eastmore all the way past the 50-yard line by about 2 feet in a first down.
So, ball moved into Ironman territory, the 49-yard line. First down for Eastmore. Long cadence. And now the snap back, and with some pressure going deep down the right side of the field, and it will be caught for the touchdown.
Wow.
Number six. That was Washington makes the touchdown. It was a shoulder touch or catch for the touchdown.
You know, and we had good coverage. We were right there. They threw it up into the lights. I'm saying they just tossed it about as high as you could, got it into the end zone. Receiver runs under it with one of our defenders right on top of him, but execution there is a 10, and that gives them six.
Absolutely. 49 yards and the lead for Eastmore. Now the extra point. Dorian Colin Suber is the kicker, soccer stuff kicker. The snapback is muffed, and then they throw it into the end zone, and incomplete. The didn't get the handle on the snap, and the holder had to pick it up and try to find somebody open, and that ball's incomplete, and that's their score, 6-3. Eastmore takes the lead, and we'll take a timeout. We'll be back right after this.
Do you have a roofing or siding project? At Higgins, they manufacture steel roofing and siding every business day. With 16 colors in stock and 70,000 pieces of trim, they are prepared to ship your project immediately. Remember Higgins for your 40-year warranted, Energy Star compliant, American-made steel roofing and siding. Located on AC Avenue, just off 35 in Jackson. Call 800-782-4239 or visit them on the web at HigginsRoofing.com.
Everyone has something that they do best. Banks are no exception. Ours is investing back into the local communities that we serve. We make loans to local families and businesses. These loans generate the dollars which empower our local community. Invest in our community by banking with us. We're an equal housing lender. Ohio Valley Bank. Community first. Member FDIC.
Six to three, Eastmore connects on a long bomb to take a 6-3 lead, and they missed the extra point. And right now we're going to have the kickoff, and then Hugh Wilson will give you a recap of that touchdown. End over end kick will be taken by Wolford at the 8-yard line. He starts up the center of the field, now kicks it to the right, cuts it back, and tackled at the 30-yard line.
Cade Wolford puts his shoulder down there and runs over a tackler. He did that twice last week. We're seeing a little more of that out of Cade as this year goes on. Pete.
All right. Eastmore on their touchdown drive. And remember, they had no first downs until that drive. Five plays, 84 yards. Of course, the big play, the 49-yard touchdown pass, the rainbow throw to Washington for the TD. They did get the aid of 20 yards in penalties there to put them in position. Extra point, though, fails after the bad snap on the would-be kick.
First and 10 for Jackson Ironman as Jake Winters takes it to, he'll keep it. He starts over the left side of his line and gets 5 yards, a little over 5 yards, out over the 35.
Jacob really been a factor running the football so far in this first half. That's a good 5-yard gain, almost 5.5. Second and a little less than 5 for the Ironman. See if we get composure back now. The momentum shifts a little bit when you don't get that extra point. You all of a sudden you're down, but you kind of come off the field excited when they bollock stack. Exactly. So let's see if we can hold on to that.
Clock down to 6 minutes and 6 minutes and change here. 5 seconds remaining. Unbalanced line for the Ironman. And winners. Fumble on the play, and the Ironman have recovered with that pill.
Well, we got flags everywhere, but I think they're markers, too, where the ball was fumbled.
We don't have a penalty. They're using markers that are basically the same color as the flag.
Yeah, there were three of them came flying out, but the ball was on the turf for a second, but the Ironman recover their own fumble.
But it's third down and six now for Jackson.
That would have been a change in momentum to turn it over right away.
Okay, let's see what the Ironman can do. Winners into the huddle. Sends Prater out here to the near side of the field. Trips to the left. And now Broman goes in motion, and he's looking right. Going down to Prater. Prater over the shoulder, and had a one-on-one carry.
You see, Tristan, he wants interference call because he was in fear right at the 50-yard line. The man basically grabbed him by the shoulder pads and held him up. I mean, it was right in front of us there, and boy, Tristan was expecting the flag, and it didn't come out. So the Ironman don't catch that break there, but he was going to beat that corner, but we just couldn't quite get the execution there when he got held up.
I have to punt it away. Back deep over Presley, and number three, Conta. 6-3, Eastmore with the lead. Jackson now to punt it away, and there's an end-over-end kick by Prater. Takes a big Ironman bounce.
That's going to be a good one.
And it will be picked up by Presley at the 22-yard line, and he steps out of bounds as he gets to, it looks like the 27, maybe the 28.
Good pursuit down there for the Ironman. Looked like Mason Lanning down there along with Jake Malone. Moves it all the way back to the 27 while Pete's doing quick math. Pete?
All right, that was a 46-yard punt by Tristan Prater, a 7-yard return by Presley, so it adds up to Eastmore starting on their own 27-yard line. Remember, they lead 6-3, only 4:52 to go here in half number one.
And it becomes a factor now where Eastmore deferred. They will also get the first possession of the second half.
The pistol formation for the Warriors as they line up.
Any of the three could end up being the quarterback, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And it looks like the quarterback. Connors gets the handoff, or gets the ball carry, and he'll go down. The Ironman defense very stingy there. That time, Lamont Armstrong, the quarterback, hands off to him, and he loses a yard.
Big play by Jacob Winters in there as the inside linebacker position on this series. Tackle for a loss, penalty also included. We can decline that one because of the defensive play by the Ironman.
So it remains, or it will be, second down and 10 as they decline the penalty.
Probably moving back to 26, maybe second and 11.
Second and 11, right. Eastmore has the lead, 6-3 over Jackson. 4 minutes and 40 seconds remain in this first half of play.
Low-scoring football game, been a defensive specialist type game. If you like defense, it's been tonight.
Here's the snap back and looking upfield, and now he pitches it out at the 30-yard line, and tackled is made by Denny at the 35, short of the first down.
A.J. Denny hustles out there, makes a play, but they have one of their linemen is down, getting up slowly, is up to his feet.
It'll be third down and a long two for Eastmore with 4:14 remaining in this first half of play.
Their trainer will walk him over to the sideline, so they'll make a substitution. Number 78 for Eastmore.
It was
76.
I thought it was 78, but he was not dressed when he started.
Huh. Might be 76. Hard to tell on their number. If it is Timothy Jacobs, he's a mere 6'5", 284.
All right, third down and two.
snap back.
Boy, that one is stuffed.
Stuffed in the back of the arm and recovered the fumble.
Boy, the arm and we're all over the backfield. A.J. Diddy comes up off the bottom of the pile with that football in hand. Harmon had people everywhere. We had Mastin and Winters in their backfield causing havoc. Ball was loose and the Army get a short field. Big turnover in this contest.
It's so good to be, and when you're at the home crowd, because the home crowd really got in that on
they
that
were
play.
Making noise, yeah, banging the bleachers and the cowbell sounds. And
the Army will start at the 29-yard line of Eastmore.
Harmon have all three timeouts and 3:50 to go here in the half.
Second ship goes in motion. Winters will take off and to the left and come back to the right. He had nowhere to go. A little high snap got the play off out of sync there, I think. And
he really made a good catch on the snap.
Yeah, the one-handed. Yeah.
We know Jacob was a good catch there, but kind of we were going to fake the jet sweep or run the jet sweep, but couldn't get it done, so he just took what he could. He ends up losing about a half yard.
And that takes the clock down to 3:25 as it continues to move. Wood, Blankenship, and Wolford out to the left, Prater to the right. Jake, the pass is complete to Wolford, and they're going to rule it incomplete. He juggled it around the 25-yard line a couple of times. When he was going down, I thought he had it, and then it pops out at the end.
Yeah, it was actually Jake Wood on the reception attempt and just couldn't quite pull it in. Would have been about a 5-yard gain. So now Ironman looking at third and long, not quite 11, but a little longer than 10.
Clock stopped at 3:07 on that incomplete pass.
Really critical to take advantage of the turnover here with the short field, but this Eastmore defense has been pretty outstanding so far in this first half.
Winners and looking to pass again, has pressure and he will go down. He's back at the 34-yard line, making that tackle for the loss was Alonzo Thorpe, number 85.
Boy, and this puts us in a tough situation. I mean, I think we're a little too far to even try an Ethan Crabtree field goal here. It would be 50, about a 50-yarder. So Jackson looking at fourth and long, and they're going to play for it from here.
They need 14. It's fourth down at the 33-yard line.
They have been able to get into our backfield. I think Coach Hall is now going to use a timeout. He's letting the time run down and decide what to do on this fourth and long situation. And that's exactly what they do.
Timeout on the field by the Airmen. 6-3, they trail Eastmore. We'll be back right after this timeout.
At Belicio Foods, commitment to the community is at the core of our company. We've been feeding people for over 25 years, and that means we've also employed folks from right here within the community. So we're proud to give a little something back. Donating to local charities and helping local organizations, we are helping to make the community closer and stronger. Belicio Foods, we're your neighbors, we're your friends, we are part of the community, and always will be.
You're listening to Jackson High School Sports on the all-new Mix 96 FM. And now, back to the action.
They've been on top of those.
2:21 remains before halftime. The Ironmen with a timeout, their first of the half, on critical fourth down and 14.
No need to save them. You lose them at halftime. So Coach Hall decides to talk this over. Fourth and what, 14? We will play for it. The ball is clear back at the 33-yard line of Eastmore.
Get down to the 19-yard line to keep this drive alive for the Ironman. They'll line up with trips to the left once again. Prater out by himself to the right. And here's Winters looking to pass. Looking. Throws it into the deep end and in zone. It is caught.
Yes. Jake Wood.
Winters did a nice job.
There was a lot of pressure on Jacob, and he once again fought his way around in the back of that pocket and bought extra time and allowed the Ironman to keep running their routes. He sees Jake Wood breaking in the end zone, and he hits him right on the number 9, And Jake Wood gets his fourth touchdown reception of the season, and the Ironmen get a big score here with just a couple minutes before halftime.
Evans to snap, Wood to hold. And here's the kick by Crabtree. It's up and good. Jackson 10. He scores 6. We'll be back right after this timeout.
We should go bowling and have the best pizza in Jackson County tonight.
Ugh, I don't want to go to two places.
Well, we don't have to. The best pizza in Jackson County comes from the local bowling alley, Liella of Wellston.
Really? No way.
Yes way. Come on in and grab a lane and the best pizza in Jackson County at Liella of Wellston. Liella of Wellston, located 15 North Park Avenue, Wellston, Ohio.
Call Liella of Wellston at 740-384-6670 to grab your pizza today.
Hey, Brad.
Yeah, Peyton.
See that couple? Classic Peytonville love story. She's a safe driver. He hardly drives at all. Both control their auto insurance rates with Nationwide.
How'd they meet?
Fate, Brad.
What's that?
Ooh, don't touch that. Wet.
Nationwide Mutual Insurance Company and Affiliates, Columbus, Ohio. Smart Ride and Smart Miles programs require enrollment. Availability and details vary. Terms and conditions apply.
Jackson regains the lead at the 2 minute and 12 second mark here. Pete Wilson.
Pete, that's doing it the hard way.
Right, four plays, 29 yards. Actually, the touchdown comes from 33 because the Ironman had a fourth and 14 situation. Jake Wood catches that ball in the middle of the end zone for the go-ahead touchdown. Crabtree kicks the extra point. Ironman lead 10-6.
And it's a squib kick by the Ironman, picked up by Eastmore, returning it. He picked it up at about the 40 or 35 yard line and returned that near midfield.
Cade Wolford gets the tackle, but that one had potential on it. And I can see with the Ironman, Eastmore has a handful of people in the open field that can do some damage to you, and we get him tackled at their 45.
Valley is the returner for Eastmore on that play, so that's a pretty good field position. Just over 2 minutes remaining before halftime.
And they still have two timeouts, each team with two timeouts now. 2:07 to go. The Ironmen have taken the lead back at 10-6.
The left hash mark as the Warriors go towards the scoreboard here in this quarter.
Stay with us. At halftime, we have a guest. We've been talking to the basketball coaches. Now we got an opportunity to talk to the wrestling coach here. We'll hear how his program's about to get started.
And here's a little counter, or let's play action, and the quarterback throws it. It's a little screen, and defended well by A.J. Denny and the Jackson Ironmen.
Beautiful job by Denny, and everybody stayed home, but we put a lot of pressure on the quarterback, Maston coming at him from the backside. They threw a little screen pass, and there was the junior defensive tackle to wrap him up, and a little to no gain, and actually no gain at all.
No huddle this time by Eastmore with the 1:35 remaining.
Both these teams average about 35 points a game. The Ironman 38, Eastmore 35, but it's 10-6 at this point in the contest.
Snap back to the quarterback, looking over the middle, looking now, throws it out in the flat, and it will be caught, and it's pushed out of bounds. Here on the near side of the field, making that catch was Harrison, Tremont Harrison.
Don't think he could have gone much higher to make that catch. He went up in the air and finger tripped that one in, but he gets the catch. He gets out of bounds, stops the clock at 1:14.
Picks up 12 for a first down.
Absolutely, and it puts him a little closer. They're at least in Hail Mary type area.
Clock's running. He did not get out of bounds.
Boy, they did not get him out of bounds there. Okay, sure looked like he was out of bounds.
Yes, it did. Okay.
Who are asked a question?
First and 10 now.
This will stop the clock.
Yeah, at 51 seconds remaining.
Confusion in their backfield, man in motion. I think it's going to cost them 5 yards. Now you're getting close to right where they threw that long touchdown pass from. If they can run that same play again, I don't know if they can duplicate that.
Yeah, it's 47-yard line. Looks like they'll make it mark at the 48-yard line. First and 15.
Braden Powell in there at a defensive tackle position for the Ironmen.
Clock is moving. And back to pass. Here's some pressure. Looking up the middle, and the ball will be, well, incomplete. The ball may have been tipped because it started out and went end over end and fell harmlessly at the 35-yard line.
A little bit of pressure coming from the outside. He stepped up in the pocket. I think he actually got bumped by his own lineman, and that caused that ball to go fluttering out there. Just nobody was in the area to make the catch.
Okay, stops the clock at 37 seconds. Still second and second down and 15.
Ball on the Jackson 48-yard line. They still have two timeouts. Haven't had to burn one yet.
Lining up at quarterback is number two, Armstrong. He has an empty backfield. Two in the slot to the right. And now penalty flag comes in, and what we got?
Easmore takes a timeout to talk things over.
That judge had actually thrown his flag as it was the delay of gain because he's the one that keeps that.
They called it before the 25-second clock ran out. Let's just keep it here since there's only 37 seconds. Pete Wilson, Easmore, actually is living on a one big play and a big penalty in the Ironman, also a couple big plays. It's been a defensive specialist game so far.
Right, and I tell you what, both teams' offenses came in with tremendous stats, and I think, I don't know whether people were expecting a shootout, but they were expecting certainly more offense than what we've seen so far, but this is a great game so far.
Physical contest on there. Stay tuned, as we mentioned, we will have Brandon Oliver talking about his wrestling program. This week, he had a wrestling camp for the little people, the little guys, and he only had about 300 in there, but I think he had 50 or 60. He'll tell us on that, but he had a lot of participation in the field house this week. He should be tired.
Okay, let's go. Second down and 15 from the 48-yard line. Empty backfield for Eastmore. Ironman's showing blitz, and here they come, and it will be the quarterback around the blitz, and now penalty flag comes in as the quarterback runs it down to the 32-yard line, but it looks like we may have had a clip or an illegal hold.
Oh, I did see the signal from the side judge. It is a holding call against Eastmore.
A.J. Denny made the tackle. Their quarterback really made some nice moves and a great effort there to take it inside the 35-yard line, but he, I think, is the one who's still down. And immediately we see Doc Owens out there checking him out, Jason Crawford.
Number two, Ahmad Armstrong, down at the 32-yard line where he was tackled, just short of the first down, I believe.
We'll see. He made positive yards. We'll see where that hold took place at. If it was downfield, it might not be too big a penalty as for him total, but he's up on his feet and running to their sideline now, so that's a good sign.
Going to move the ball back to their own 40-yard line.
Boy, that hold must have taken place back in the backfield.
Yeah, absolutely. Big penalty for Easmore. Good break for the Ironmen.
Line of scrimmage was at the 48, so the penalty did happen in the backfield at the 50-yard line.
Well, there is only 28 seconds left. They have one timeout left. We'll see if they have a trick play of some sort here to keep this drive alive. It's second and a mile, 27 yards they need.
Devin Lloyd with the football, and he throws it out in the flat to the right side. It's caught, and turning it upfield and then stepping out of bounds is Tremont Harrison. And that takes the clock down to 14 seconds.
Gets it out near midfield, but still going to be second, third in a long way.
Jackson leads 10-6. With 14 seconds remaining in this first half of play. Ball at the 49-yard line of Eastmore. Third down and about 18. And snap back, looking, one, and flushed out of the pocket, and still
on his feet now. He will go down at the 45-yard line.
Good pressure there by Ty Jones, and a couple of the other airmen made the quarterback run out of the pocket, and there was number 57 to wrap him up and bring him down for a tackle for a loss.
1.9 seconds remain.
Did they take their last time out?
He
must have, because it did stop the clock.
Timeout.
They did.
Their second charge.
Jackson.
Timer. Reset the clock to 3.0.
3 seconds back up on the scoreboard. And now the two teams huddled around their benches. And Ironman wanted to force a punt, maybe?
Interesting. It is fourth down. It is fourth and long. 21 yards to go. Actually, we had the sack, so I think the first half would have run out unless Eastmore takes the timeout. But either way, we got Coach Taylor in the middle of that huddle talking to his defense. And when you think about it, you know, Dan, we're just about halftime. Our defense gave up the one long Hail Mary pass. Pete called it, what'd you call it, a rainbow pass? Or a, it was out of the clouds. They threw it up in the air and they were able to execute it. That's the only points we've given up for 2.5 games now. We have back-to-back shutouts going, and that's the only score we've given up. So defense, they got to feel awfully good about. It certainly was a big touchdown on 4th and 14 to give the Ironmen the lead. Winners to Woods.
Well, we're ready for play. 3 seconds remains before halftime. It's 4th, and now a timeout has been called by...
Timeout. By us again. Yeah, we're gonna talk it over. We'll take a break now.
All
we'll
right.
Wear them out if we keep talking through timeouts.
All right, 10-6 is your score. We'll be back right after this.
We should go bowling and have the best pizza in Jackson County tonight.
Ugh, I don't want to go to two places.
Well, we don't have to. The best pizza in Jackson County comes from the local bowling alley, Liella of Wellston.
Really? No way.
Yes way. Come on in and grab a lane and the best pizza in Jackson County at Liella of Wellston. Liella of Wellston, located 15 North Park Avenue, Wellston, Ohio.
Call Liella of Wellston at 740-384-6670 to grab your pizza today.
You're listening to Jackson High School Sports on the all-new Mix 96 FM. And now, back to the action.
Where the scoreboard may show 3 seconds, but it seems like it takes 30 minutes to play.
It's been a while here in the last few seconds. Everybody had their full timeouts. Now there's just one left in there. The Eastmore still has one left, but they only have 3 seconds. It is fourth down. They're going to play for it.
From the 45-yard line, looking down the far side of the field, and the ball will be tipped and then incomplete. And that will end the first half of play. Jackson leads Eastmore Warriors 10-6. What an entertaining but no scoring first half.
Well, it's old style football in this one. It's not one of those shootouts. It's the first 1-35 going to win this contest, and maybe it still end up that way, but it doesn't look like it. Both teams' defenses are very strong. 10-6 is about what this one should be, and each team has had to convert kind of a, I don't want to call it a miracle, but they had the long bomb from midfield to score their only touchdown. We had to convert a 4th and 14 to score our only touchdown. Really, the only legitimate points that you think of is the field goal by Ethan Crabtree. But either way, Jackson has that 10-6 lead in a real dandy football game, and that's what playoff football should be all about.
All right, it's week number 12 of the high school playoff season, and Jackson leads Columbus Eastmore 10-6 at halftime. We'll take a break, and we'll be back right after this.
From the Ohio News Network, this is the Ohio Education Association Tonight in High School Football. Named best sports program in the country by the National Association of State Radio Networks. Tonight in High School Football is presented by Bex Hybrids and by Ohio for Responsible Gambling. Now here's your host, Skip Mossick.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Tonight in High School Football's Halftime Reports. Well, how did the first weekend of the expanded playoffs go? We'll discuss that, as well as some of the other fall sports championships upcoming with Tim Streed of the OHSAA next on the Ohio News Network.
Farmers at heart. At Beck's, that's who we are. For over 100 years, the Beck family has lived and farmed in central Indiana. Today, we're proud to serve a dedicated community of farmers in Ohio. To us, helping farmers succeed means so much more than just being a great seed supplier. Our family of employees and dealers are committed to helping farmers seek new challenges.
one more time for the Columbus Eastmore High School band. Sam Google and Mary Elizabeth Millman, Coach Instructor Keith Wilson, Auxiliary Instructors Tiffany Bertrand and Alicia Mannering, and Special Interns Katie King and Nathan Clemens, we proudly present to you the 2021 edition of the Pride of Jackson, the Jackson High School Marching. And marching airmen revisit their favorite sounds of the season. To start, we celebrated 97 years of Walt Disney magic. Our opening sound included the ice cold hit Into the Unknown from Frozen 2. Next up, it feels like the perfect night to celebrate our seniors, the Jackson Marching Airmen Class of 2022. The next song, chosen by our seniors, is appropriately Taylor Swift's 22. Yes, we see what you did there, seniors. Thank you. The marching army closed tonight with a hit song from the Doobie Brothers. It's been a Jackson tradition many, many years. Get on your feet, ladies and gentlemen. Here it is. Long Train Running! Desire to stay close to the game and want to contribute to the educational experience of student athletes, you can become an OHSAA contest official where open positions are always available. To get started, check out OHSAA.org/officiating today. From other tournament games around the area, Western Brown is up 28-20 over the Bell Fountain Chieftains at halftime. Over St. Francis DeSales, 7-6. Also in the region, Bishop Hartley, 10-3 over London.
I must learn to be a good student during school.
If I want to be able to put my uniform on after school.
Receive the ball to start the second half. Kickoff was returned by number 3, Muhammad Khanna. Several higher men in the stop. It'll be 1st and 10 for Eastmore on the 30-yard line. Intercepted by number 8, Kay Wolford. There is a flag. There is a flag on the play. Sportsmanlike conduct the call against the Ironmen. First and 10 Eastmore on the 49-yard line.
Easy.
Pass was intended for number 28, Eli Rahrman. Second and 10 for the Ironmen. Jacob Winters, the ball carrier for the Ironmen. Just short of the first down. Third and one, Jackson on the 41. Winters the ball carrier. The run is good for an Ironman first down. First and 10, Jackson on the East 440. Wolford, the ball carrier for the Ironmen. Gain of one makes it second and nine on the 39. Pass intended for number 14, Justin Prater. Third down.
For heaven to see
you.
Yeah,
I would say Jacob has had a lot of pressure on him every time we've dropped back.
And number six is Washington, not
the few times he's been able to elude the pressure and keep his feet under him is when we've made those big pass plays.
Wood and Blankenship and Wolford all to the left for the Jackson. Third down. On the 39 yard line. Here's a pass, and it will be nearly picked off.
Pass intended for number nine.
At the 30 yard line. Boy.
Just over the outstretched hands of Jake Wood, it goes incomplete. One of the deep backs for South had an opportunity there, couldn't quite dig it out, but it'll be a fourth and very long, and it looks like Jackson's going to bring the punt team out.
And back for the Warriors and Muhammad Cuthy and Presley, Isaiah Presley, number 11, around the 10-yard line.
Part of the field, you got your up back is Drew Bragg. We were able to use a fake punt earlier this year, not this time.
And gets a high punt, and they're caught at the inside the 10. He did not call for a fair catch, and boy, the Ironman right there to wrap him up.
Jake Malone was down there in a hurry and put a big hit on him inside the 10-yard line. Big play by the Jackson punt team. Good high kick by Tristan, who normally likes to kick that line drive kick. That one he put high up in the air, and boy, the coverage was there.
32-yard punt there by Prater. Can't do it much better than that. Made him field the punt at the 7-yard line in case, you know, there was a fumble or something.
And Eastmore's going to start very deep in their own territory at their own 7-yard line.
All right, thank you, Pete. It's 9 minutes and 3 seconds remaining in this third quarter. Jackson leading 10-6. Washington out wide and right for the Warriors. And right here on the near side is number two, Armstrong, in for a fumble in the backfield. He's in the end zone. He'll have to try to run it out, and he gets back to the line of scrimmage. They're just shy of the line of scrimmage at the 5-yard line.
Looked like Grant Mastin chasing down, made the tackle there for a second. We're thinking safety, but he was able to get past the goal line and at least advance it out around the 3. Maybe they'll mark him near the 4-yard line, about the 3-yard line.
A loss of 4 on the play, second and 14 now.
This is big. Let's see if our defense here can take advantage. They've been nothing short of spectacular again tonight. 10-6, the very small Ironman lead.
Trips out here the near side of the field for Eastmore. Quarterback stands in the end zone as he fumbles the ball, and it will be picked up by the quarterback, but he will get back maybe to the line of scrimmage.
That's about it. And boy, they have had some issues with their snaps tonight. That's two in a row that have been right at the ankle of the quarterback.
On the bottom of that file, and now it's third down at 13. For the Warriors.
Tucker Williams reports into the Ironman at one of the safety positions. Here's a big play for our defense. Third and a bunch.
Presley and Harrison out to the left. Backs are staying in the back or in the end zone. That was there. Quarterback Keith, he's spun around and he will go down. Loss on the play. Back to the 2-yard line.
I couldn't see. Somebody hit him first on, but boy, then we wrapped him up. And I think it was Xander Karagosian who comes limping off, but he's the one that made the tackle back around the 3-yard line, maybe a little inside the 3, and that punter now for Eastmore is going to have his heels near the back of the end zone.
That's 83 Dixon will punt it away. The Army should get great field position to see what the Army can.
Hate to see this. Andrew Karagosian comes to the sideline. He is immediately being tended to by Jason Crawford. Hopefully it's a cramp. That's what it looks like they're treating him as.
There's the snap on 4th and 14. And kick is away. And the airmen come up to take it at the 27-yard line. And tackle at the 22.
Holden Blankenship, tremendous job at catching that punt. Wasn't far, wasn't high. He had to step up with the defense in his face, made the catch. And that's big because you don't get those roll yards. And the airmen have a very short field here. Let's see if we can take advantage of it.
Pete?
Give the punter there a 23-yard punt. Under pressure, of course, because of where it came from. He was near the back of the end zone when he kicked that. Blankenship picked up the short punt that was high in the air and got a 3-yard return.
From the left hash mark, first to 10 for the Ironman. And here's the winners looking to play action. Going into the corner of the end zone. And no, he'll go down. Wanted to pass it, and did we fumble the ball?
Well, the ball came out of his hands, and I'm telling you, Eastmore thinks they got it. They have one of their players come up off the top of a pile. Now the officials are going to decide whether Jacob was in a throwing motion and treated as an incomplete pass, but they're not going to do that. They're going to call it a fumble and a turnover, and Eastmore comes up
wow.
with it, and that is a big, big play after the Ironman had such good field position here.
All right, well, Eastmore will take over on the Ironman fumble at their own 27-yard line.
I think Jacob trying to pump fake there, and the ball kind of slips out of his hand, and it ends up being a turnover, and the Eastmore gets the football back. Boy, that's a couple change of events there, Pete.
And they've got some breathing room, too.
Sure was, Jackson. A couple golden opportunities in Eastmore territory, but turned away on one drive, and then on this one, give up the fumble on the unforced error. Eastmore still in their own territory, deep at the 27-yard line. They've not been able to do much except for that long pass, but they've got another opportunity now.
6:33 remaining third quarter. Jackson 10, Eastmore 6. And Eastmore, here's the handoff straight up the middle. And the runner fights for some yardage, maybe gets 5. Second effort there gives him
5, maybe 6-yard gain, got to the 32.
Did fight hard for that, but boy, we're midway through the third quarter. 10-6, your score still. And it felt like Jackson's had a couple opportunities already to increase the lead, but haven't been able to put the points on the board.
Well, they break the huddle, it's 2nd and 4, ball at their own 33-yard line. And whistle was blown before the play developed. Take a timeout. No indication by...
No, the officials stopped play. And now they're just letting them line back up.
It will remain 2nd down and 4.
They said start the clock, so...
Inside 6 minutes now here in the third quarter. The Ironmen leading it 10-6.
Pete had a good stat in the pregame saying that Eastmore has lost 3 times this year, but all 3 teams that beat him are well into the playoffs, so they've only been beat by good people.
Low snap, picked up by the quarterback, out to the... And the running back is out here to the left side and picking up nice yardage. That's number 21, runner. And he has the first down for the Warriors.
Nolan Johnson helps run him out of bounds there, getting some play in there with Xander Karagosian coming off with that ankle issue.
Be out to their own 46-yard line, but well, imagine where they were just moments ago punting from your end zone.
They got to feel real good about their situation because they were so close to having a safety twice on tough snaps into the end zone there, but now they've got a turnover and they're back near midfield.
Evan Lloyd at quarterback for the Warriors. 1st and 10. High snap, but he controls it, and then and he will go down. Looks like he wanted to give it in the belly to his running back, but he couldn't get it there. And
now Jackson thinks they have the football. Let's see what the call is. Ty Jones in there. He was saying the Ironman got it recovered, but I don't think they're going to give it to us. Coach Hall thought we had it. He was pointing the other direction.
Sure looked like an Ironman recovery, but or just a takeaway.
Yeah, a takeaway more than anything. But, boy, a lot of pressure there. Norris and Denny Jones all involved in there. The loss on the play of 2 yards.
2nd down and 12 with 5 minutes. 5 seconds to go in the third quarter.
Playoff football is what we're watching.
Now runner goes in motion and quarterback pumps one. Now he's going to take off and run. Gets around the corner on the left side. And Jacob Winters brings him down near midfield.
Big play there by the junior inside linebacker. Also doubles as a quarterback. But boy, a nice tackle there in the open field by Jacob Winters to keep that from being a big play.
It's 3rd down and 6 coming up. The ball rests right at the 50-yard line.
Tackles in there. Winters and Madison, the two inside linebackers. Ty Jones, the nose. Xander Karagosian back on the field for the Ironmen.
And the clock to the right side. And now they got trips out there. They have to take a timeout.
Clock was about to run down for a 5-yard penalty. I hated to do that, so they'll burn a timeout.
And we'll do the same with 4:09 remaining third quarter. We'll be back right after this timeout.
We should go bowling and have the best pizza in Jackson County tonight.
Ugh, I don't want to go to 2 places.
Well, we don't have to. The best pizza in Jackson County comes from the local bowling alley, Liella of Wellston.
Really? No way.
Yes way. Come on in and grab a lane. And the best pizza in Jackson County at Liella of Wellston. Liella of Wellston, located 15 North Park Avenue, Wellston, Ohio.
Call Liella of Wellston at 740-384-6670 to grab your pizza today.
You're listening to Jackson High School Sports on the all-new Mix 96 FM. And now, back to the action.
The crowd, home crowd, got into it a little bit there and forced the Warriors to take another timeout. They're looking at 3rd down and 6.
I think we forced a couple timeouts by Eastmore tonight just by the crowd being involved in this one. More students here tonight. There was a great job there by some donors that they had a food drive, and if the kids brought in canned food, they got a ticket for tonight's game. And there's a great student section down there. Good support here from the Jackson sideline. And they're witnessing a heck of a football game.
All right, here we go. 3rd down and 6 from midfield. Devin Lloyd has Brunner standing beside him in the backfield. And now take the snap. Has backside pressure. Takes off and he will run, but he'll end up short of the first down at the 46.
They got a decision here to make, Mr. Dobbins. Yes, they're going to be about a yard and a half short. Fourth down. Maybe make it 2 yards.
Yeah, looks closer to two.
Let's see what they decide to do. Ball marked about the 46-yard line. They're just a little outside the 46. They need to get to the 44. It looks like they're going to play for it.
As the clock ticks down to 3 minutes and 40 seconds here in the third quarter.
Boy, this is a big, big play here. Keep this drive alive for Eastmore. Our defense has been nothing but outstanding again tonight.
Here we go. Big play for Eastmore. Runner takes the snap and the pass is caught in the left foot and finally tackled at the 37-yard line.
Gutsy call by Eastmore, but they executed it. The little post pattern there, a short post pattern by their wide out, and the quarterback put it right on the mark, and they were able to move those first down markers.
And they're now in Ironman territory at the 37-yard line, and they are trailing Jackson by 4, 10-6.
Big play, Pete Wilson.
It was, and that certainly surprised me. We need this 2 yards. I figure it's going to be a run for sure, but they rolled the dice. They came up snake eyes.
And Lloyd takes the snap, hands off to Brenner, and he is hit a couple of times, but able to squeeze and fall forward to the 35-yard line. Gain of about 2.
Jones, Karagosian, everybody hits him early there, but he's able to break through, cross the line of scrimmage, and Maston puts the finishing touches on him, but after that, he only gains about 2 yards. Ball right at the 35-yard line.
It's second down and 8.
Is this the farthest Eastmore's come down the field, Pete, except for the long touchdown bomb pass?
I believe this is the deepest thing. Been.
Yep.
Presley out wide to the right with Conta in the slot. Lloyd sends a man in motion, now takes the snap, rolls to his right. He's got pressure, sets it up, and it's big. He's at midfield and still on the feet at the 40 and finally tackled at the 35-yard line.
Cade Wolford with the interception and an excellent return, but they're saying the ball was knocked loose as he's tackled, and it looks like they're going to give it back to Eastmore. Wow, what a play. Cade makes the interception, catches it on the dead run, runs up the Eastmore sideline. Looks like he has it all the way down to the 35-yard line, but he's kind of gang tackled there. The ball comes up loose, and it looks like Eastmore has the football back. That's what the official's calling.
At their own 35-yard line with 1:45 to go third quarter. Boy, a big change of a lot of pressure on the quarterback that time. Forced the errant throw. Wolford in perfect position to pick it off. Returning it down that far side of the field, but ends up turning the ball back over. So it's first and 10. Now a new quarterback comes in and he'll keep it and he'll be dropped for a loss on the play.
Ty Jones. Outstanding senior nose guard. Another big play there. Brings him down.
Armstrong does the job for the Ironman defense. Loses 1 yard.
Second and 11. 1:04 to go in the third quarter. This game keeps moving on. It's a 10-6 football game, folks. Both teams, I guess you could say now, have had some opportunities.
Eastmore elects to put it in the air on second and long from their own 34-yard line. And a handoff. Well, he takes the handoff and he'll keep it. He'll go down at the line of scrimmage. There'll be no gain on that play as Drew Bragg first in there to get him.
Well, and Jacob Winters in there. Boy, did a nice job getting him low, and Drew Bragg wraps him up and brings him down. Winters has had a couple big plays. We kind of spot play him in there at that inside linebacker position. You hate to have your quarterback play every snap in there, but he has been a factor every time he's been on the field tonight.
It's third down, and the game clock is down to 10 seconds, and Eastmore, I think, is going to be satisfied to stay in the huddle, and we're going to go to the fourth quarter.
12 more minutes.
With your score, Jackson 10, Eastmore 6,
We'll be back with fourth quarter action right after this timeout.
When you think of your community bank, are you thinking of leading technology? Things like mobile banking and mobile deposit? Being able to pay a friend using Zelle? Are you thinking of best-in-class bill pay and customized account alerts? If you're thinking of those things, then you must be thinking of Jackson County Banking Center. They have leading technology and local support. And by local, we mean right here in your neighborhood. Leading technology, local support. That's Jackson County Banking Center. Member FDIC.
Hey, Brad.
Yeah, Peyton.
See that couple? Classic Peytonville love story. She's a safe driver. He hardly drives at all. Both control their auto insurance rates with Nationwide.
How'd they meet?
Fate, Brad.
What's that?
Ooh, don't touch it. Wet.
Nationwide Mutual Insurance Company and Affiliates, Columbus, Ohio. Smart Ride and Smart Miles programs require enrollment. Availability and details vary. Terms and conditions apply.
This is Virgil Hamilton. For all your insurance needs, stop by our office in Jackson, Ironton, or Chesapeake, or check us out on Facebook or virgilhamilton.com.
Welcome back. Jackson Ironman football regional quarterfinal tournament action as the Columbus Eastmore Warriors are in town to take on the Jackson Ironman. Right now it's 10-6 Jackson.
Pete Wilson, very interesting third quarter to have no points scored.
Right, I tell you, kind of like a ping pong, the momentum is because of turnovers, basically. Jackson with the more opportunities than Eastmore, but nonetheless, the score remains the same, 10-6. Jackson, good down and distance situation for the defense. Third and 10 for Eastmore from their own 35-yard line. The Ironmen can get another stop here.
As we open up fourth quarter, Lloyd. Then playing quarterback, this runner in motion, back, drops back to pass, going deep down the right side of the field and way overthrown, the intended receiver, number 5, Tramon Harris.
Trying to attack one of the top corners in all of Southeast Ohio, Tristan Prater. He had that one very well covered. The throw was too long. And we will force Eastmore into a punt here, and the Ironmen are going to get an opportunity here with a 10-6 lead.
And
points have been precious.
They are at a premium tonight. It's number 83, the kicker, the punter, Aaron Dixon, stands inside his 25-yard line.
We've had a couple fumbles, but Eastmore has certainly struggled a lot of times with snaps, either to the punter or to their shotgun quarterbacks.
This kick is, or snap is back, and good one, and here's the catch, or the taken by Wolford, and Wolford straight up the middle of the field. He has a nice return from the 38-yard line into Eastmore territory, the 47-yard line.
Pretty high, good spiral kick, and Cade stepped right up with good coverage around him and caught that ball and was able to make an excellent return and get it back into our side of, or their side of the 50, Pete.
27-yard punt there by Dixon, but a 16-yard return by Cade.
All right, first and 10. Jackson, as Jacob Winters trots onto the field and the huddle, delivers the play. And line up very tight. Splits, unbalanced to the right side. Backs are split, and they'll run to the weak side. And it's Broman getting to the 45-yard line. Gain of about 2 on the play.
Running a little bit away from the unbalanced. Found just a little bit of room. Picked up 2 yards on first down. The Ironmen have had some excellent field position situations tonight. But as we've said, our only touchdown came on a 4th-and-14 long pass into the end zone.
Yes, that's right. Second down. Ball at the 45. And wing back around and trying to get to the corner and nowhere to go. That was Holden Blankenship losing about a half a yard on the play.
Kind of the jet sweep inside handoff to him. We see their coaching staff, which is right next to us in their booth, cheering on their defense. And you got to give credit to their defense. They have had an outstanding night.
Certainly.
Two teams that averaged 35 points, 38 for us. And the score now in the fourth quarter is 10-6.
Everybody in tight for the Ironman. Level wing situation and formation. And Winter wants to pass. Got some blocking. Eyes protection. Looking. Now he can take off and run. He's got the first down and
Whitmore into the 32-yard line.
Joy Jacobs been so strong running the football tonight, and those have been very, very big plays. One of the Eastmore players is down, and it looks like he is in a cramped situation, but Jacob with the big gallop, Pete Wilson, he's got some rushing yards tonight for us, and they've been hard to come by.
Looks like 12 carries, 53 yards for Jacob.
They've all been tough ones on there, but there's stoppage in play while the one player is down, and they are treating him for a cramp, so it's like don't think anything
the,
too serious.
Armstrong, the quarterback, or one of their quarterbacks on the field.
I think that's a couple cramps we've had. That tells you how hard fought this game is, because it's a brisk night up there. It's not the kind of night you'd think you'd be cramping up at, but these players are playing at such a ferocious type atmosphere. I mean, they are going at each other.
Certainly are.
That's what Coach Oliver from the wrestling team said. This is one hard-hitting game. The first half was, and the third quarter was nothing to change so far.
Yeah, ditto there on the third quarter. No score, but boy, teams moved the ball up and down.
Each team turned it over a little bit, had some issues. Each team had opportunities, but we're still sitting where we started this second half at 10-6. That player is still on his back, but he's being helped up now, so we're not far from getting play again. Jacob gets the big first down. We have another short field situation. Ball's at the 33-yard line.
All right, it's first and 10 for the Ironman.
Don't you feel a touchdown here would sure... I mean, it's more than a seven-point lead. That feels huge in a game like this.
It does, and... The lead right now is 4 as the extra point try was missed by Eastmore. Here's the winner's handing off left side, and that's Kane. Wolverty's got another first down.
Yeah, a great lead block in there by Grant Maston. They put him in the backfield, and I just watched him make tremendous contact with one of their linebackers. Kate follows him and picks up first down yardage on that snap.
Moves it down to the 21-yard line in the center of the field. Jackson breaks the huddle. Slot to the left side of the field. Wood and Frater over there. Backs are split, and here's Wolford. And he's got some running room down to the 15. And tackled at the 10-yard line for another first down.
Another nice job left side of that offensive line. Messer over there. Oh. O'Brien also, and then you got the lead block in there by Maston, and Cade taking advantage of it, takes it down to the 10. So right at the 10-yard line where he's guarded, it's a first down, it's first and goal.
And now clock down to 9 minutes and 30 seconds remaining in the game. Jackson with the 10-6 lead, trying to add another one on. Winner, Bill Wolford. Wolford left side, or right side, and... Yeah, about a yard gain on that play as he dives over that right tackle side.
Good to see Maston back healthy. That's such a factor for the Ironman. He's been banged up a little bit off and on through this year, but talk about utilizing one of the truly outstanding linebackers in all of Southeast Ohio here in the backfield as a lead blocker.
Second and goal from the 9. Winners, left
Boom.
Side, and boy, a nice job by the defender runner who had went off the field offensively as he was had the cramp. He comes back in and meets Wolford right at the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, another good lead block by Maston, but boy, that was excellent pursuit by Eastmore to tackle us at the 9. Nothing has come easy tonight.
Okay, it's third and goal from the 9-yard line. Backs again are split for the Airmen. Winners. Little play action going into the end zone. The ball will be caught. And touchdown! Jackson, you'll never see a better play.
I don't know. Maybe we have because that young man, we have seen a lot of them from him. What a spectacular job of coming back for the football. Goes high up in the air, makes the catch about the 1, and then dives over the cone to get the score.
Well, the defender was just right at him, yes.
What a huge play by number 14.
And now the extra point. Evans to snap, Wood to hold, and here's Crabtree to tack on another point.
And this one is up, and it is good. 17-6 is the score. 8:08 remaining in the ballgame, and we'll be back with more Jackson Ironman football after this timeout.
The Jackson County Health Department HOPE Initiative is offering free naloxone to those who wish to have a supply of the life-saving medication. Opiates take lives, and naloxone saves them. Get your free naloxone kit. Stop by the health department or call, and they can mail it to you. They also offer contactless delivery. Help save someone's life with free naloxone. Provided by the Jackson County Health Department. 200 East Main Street in Jackson. Call 740-286-5094. Stop overdoses. Carry naloxone.
As your community bank, we offer a different approach to financial service. When you become a customer, you become a friend. Like any good friend, we're dedicated to giving you the financial answers and solutions that you and your family deserve. We'll do our best to help you achieve your financial goals. We're an equal housing lender. Ohio Valley Bank. Community first. Member FDIC.
Seventeen to six, the Jackson Ironmen take the two-score lead, and here's Ethan Crabtree's kickoff. He will kick it away, and it will be taken at the 18-yard line, far side of the field. And it's Tony number three. He's got some room down the sideline. Here he goes. 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown. He scores.
I'm looking for flags. I don't see any. He went all the way up that far sideline. Do you see one? There is one, maybe about the 39-yard line. And wow, what a shame if it is for Eastmore, because what a spectacular kickoff return when they needed it most. But I think the flag is going to bring it back, and the head referee is saying exactly that.
That was Muhammad Tate, number three, taking it. And racing down that far sideline, untouched, apparently. But we do have a marker thrown at the 39.
It's going to go against Eastmore, and the Ironmen catch a big break there. And the penalty is found and caught. And obviously that was part of the return, because they threw it right where the receiver or the return man ran by. But that'll mark them back probably about to the 29-yard line, and the Ironmen defense catches a little break there, because that would have put Eastmore right back in this football game. A two-score lead in this kind of game seems like a lot, but it was almost erased pretty quickly.
All right, Pete Wilson, how about that drive by the Ironman to score?
All right, well, we'll go back to that. 8 plays, 47 yards to the Ironman. The touchdown comes on that beautiful catch by the pylon by Tristan Prater. Crabtree tacks on the extra point. Ironman leads 17-6.
All right.
How many spectacular catches have we seen number 14 make in his career?
And here's a kind of inside handoff to Brunner, and Brunner down over the 30, maybe to the 34-yard line.
Karagosian with the tackle. We've said that a whole bunch of times tonight.
And whistles on the field that stops the clock. 7:41 to go. We have an injury.
It's an official's timeout. One of their players is down.
Again, appears to be, cramp. His trainer out working on the injured player.
A little pressure on Eastmore right now in this kind of game. They have to pretty much get points on the board on this drive, or they're going to run out of time. 7:41 to go in the contest. We have the 11-point lead.
Looks as if the injured player down with the cramp is the same one was injured just moments ago before the
Eastmore had no first downs in that first quarter. They do have seven now, but boy, everything's been hard tracking for them. Take away the one pass when they went up and over the top and scored. Our defense has been truly outstanding again tonight.
It is number 21, Tyreek Brunner. He's off the field, and we're ready now with the second down and long four for Eastmore. Quarterback taking the snap, looking, going deep, and a man out there, and it's overthrown. Froerman on the coverage for the Ironman. Threw that one down to about the 30-yard line, far side of the field, but well out of the reach of the receiver.
Both safeties, Froerman and Wolford, had him well blanketed, and the throw was long. Now they look at a third and four, and this is a big play. They really are in trouble if they have to punt. Blankenship comes on the field as one of the cornerbacks.
from their 35-yard line. Lloyd, low snap, now looking, he'll force out of the pocket, and he'll throw it upfield, and the ball will be incomplete and broken up over there on the far side of the field.
Holden Blankenship with excellent coverage, and he went up with good coverage on it. I think the ball might have hit him in the helmet. He had the man blanketed coverage-wise. It goes incomplete, and the Ironman defense now looking a fourth and four, and let's see what Eastmore wants to do. I think they almost feel they got a punt now to stay in the game.
Still 7:17 remaining in the game, but Eastmore down by two scores at 17-6.
Clock becoming a Jackson Ironman friend at the moment.
Eastmore in punting formation. Nobody back deep yet for the Ironman. And officials take a timeout.
Yeah, you want to make sure that you're talking at least to your punt return team to be looking for the fake. Second clock is running right at the moment. The officials seem to have stopped everything, but the official now is signaling it's his timeout, but they'll put 25 back on the clock.
Fourth down and a long four. Dixon in punting formation. Nobody back deep for Jackson. Seven 17 remaining in the game. Jackson looks like they're going to show blitz.
He may have some movement up there, but no, nothing called yet.
And for a block, and gets the punt away. It's a very short, but high, but short kick. Going to take a Eastmore roll, and it'll be down around the 30-yard line.
Pretty good job defensively there by Jackson. You don't have to return that punt. You do not want to get fooled on a fake by any chance. They had nobody deep. Eastmore gets a bit of a roll, Pete Wilson.
35-yard punt there with the roll. Jackson, though, gets possession from their own 30-yard line, and now they're looking to eat some clock, I'm sure.
You know, we're here to see Coach Hall out there discussing things with Jacob Winters, but see who else was in the huddle? Grant Matheson also, and that certainly was a big factor on that last drive. Grant being a lead blocker for Cade Wooford. Cade had some excellent runs to get us down to that 10-yard line.
And it's first and 10 for the Ironman. Winters under center and hands off to Wolford. And from the right side, Bruner comes in and hits Wolford in the backfield. He does fall forward to the line of scrimmage.
That's quickness because he came from way outside on that formation to get in there and make the tackle at the line of scrimmage.
The line of scrimmage is the 30-yard line of the Ironman.
We'll go into more of a spread formation now. But the clock is running, and that's a factor right now. We're under 7 minutes to go. 6:35, and Ironman with the 17-6 lead.
And they break the huddle and on the right hash mark. Everybody lines up tight. And they pitch it around the end of the left side, or right side, and it's a Blankenship with the carry of about 4, maybe 5 yards.
Picks up positive yards, looking at a long third and five now.
Beam around the left end, and it follows convoy and blockers there. Third down, a long five for the Ironman. Coach Hall sending play into Kristen Trader. Trader with that spectacular catch to get the Ironman their second touchdown.
That's a good description of it. It was special.
Jake Wood goes out wide to the right side, and here's Broman with
hole.
The carry. He's got the first down out near midfield, and tackled at the 46, but that's a new first down for the Ironman. And that keeps the ball in our possession and the chains moving.
How about that offensive line? Trent Evans over there, David Norris, Caleb McGraw, big hole at the point of attack, and Eli takes advantage of it, moves it all the way out to the 46. And boy, now we eat into some clock. That's a big first down.
Eastmore has two timeouts. Sure they don't want to take them just yet.
Airman spread the field, wideouts to both sides. Five man front. Then Wolford in motion, hand off to Broman. He gets the carry and gets 3 yards out to the 49.
Every 2-3-4 yard gain right now, big.
Jackson trying to
win playoff game number 10 in school history.
And take on the winner of Weston Brown and Bell Fountain. Next Friday.
Could be
night.
Our sixth win at Alumni Stadium. When we've had home field advantage, we've taken advantage of it.
Okay, second and 7. Winners up under center, sends Wilford in motion to pitch it to him, trying to get the end or corner on the right side, cuts it back, now steps around the tackler and still on his feet, finally wrestled down at the 47-yard line of Eastmore.
A lot of good blocks out there. Cade keeps his feet moving, puts us in a third and very doable, a third and a long 2, maybe 3.
A timeout has been called by Eastmore with 4 minutes, 11 seconds remaining in the game. We'll break away and we'll be back right after this. 47.
At Belicio Foods, commitment to the community is at the core of our company. We've been feeding people for over 25 years, and that means we've also employed folks from right here within the community. So we're proud to give a little something back. Donating to local charities and helping local organizations, we are helping to make the community closer and stronger. Belicio Foods, we're your neighbors, we're your friends, we are part of the community, and always will be.
You're listening to Jackson High School Sports on the all-new Mix 96 FM. And now, back to the action.
Just 4 minutes and 11 seconds remain in the regulation or in this game, and Jackson with the 17-6 lead and the football.
Wow.
Third down and long 2 for the Ironman, ball at the 47-yard line.
Strategy here, you'd sure want to convert a first down. You can really put pressure on Eastmore. They're down to 1 timeout left.
Everybody getting tight for the Jackson Ironman. Winner sends the man in motion. They hand off to Broman. He's got the first down at the 43-yard line.
Good blocking in there for the Ironman. Looked like Norris got a good block in there. McGraw always does that, senior center. Good hole at the point of attack right over the middle of that offensive line, and we get a big, big first down. Now Eastmore with 1 timeout. We're at 4 minutes to go, and the clock is running.
Golfer comes off the field. Replaced in there by Braden Powell.
Braden Powell's in there. He'll be a lead, a blocker from the backfield probably.
And winners come to the sideline, so they are going to have to get this play off in a hurry or take a timeout.
They are not going to get it off. Let's see what happens, and they'll take a timeout. Good call there by Coach Hall.
All right, another timeout on the field. 3:33 remaining. You're listening to Jackson Ironman football on Mix 96 FM.
Hi, it's Kylie, and you know what time of year it is, football time. And our friends at Jackson Express, home of Big Papa's Pizza, Subs, Chicken, and more, have got you covered before or after the game. My dad just loves picking up a pizza and subs or even chicken tenders with potato wedges, and he always gets my favorite, the super cheesy pizza. Jackson Express has it all, including veals, mac and cheese bites, loaded potato bites, and more, so stop by today and dine in or carry out.
Jackson Express on East Main Street next to Toro Loco. Call 286-3811.
You're listening to Jackson High School Sports on the all-new Mix 96 FM. And now, back to the action.
3 minutes, 33 seconds remains in regulation as the Jackson Ironman leading 17-6.
Coach Hall wisely there takes a timeout. We still have 2, but didn't want to give up the 5 yards. 3:33 to go, 1st and 10. We can burn some clock here and probably force Eastmore to maybe consider using their last timeout. Pete, you see anything interesting? You're scanning.
Yes, quick scores. Western Brown 35, Bell Fountain 20 in the third quarter. In the fourth quarter, Granville 19, DeSales 6.
Guarantee you this football team would love a rematch with Mount Orb.
Here is otherwise known as Western Brown.
Right. Mount Orb, Western Brown. My bad.
Okay. It's a pickup of a couple on that first down carry by the airman. And now we have an injury. Someone slow getting up. Officials stop the clock momentarily as number 53 for Eastmore is going to get up at the mark target. Did they take the full timeout?
They might have taken their last timeout. I haven't seen the head official say anything, but they've sent both teams to each sideline and they're huddled up. Let's see what they call here. haven't seen the head officials do anything. He's just looking at his watch, I think.
No signals. And an injury.
If it's an injury timeout, we might see a lot of this because that's one way they can stop the clock.
Will be second down.
Well, they did use a timeout. They burnt their last timeout. 3:18 to go. They have no more timeouts. We are at second down. We can eat up some valuable seconds here.
All rest right at the 40-yard line. The Army going towards the scoreboard here at Alumni Stadium.
Even if we snap it three times and do not get a first down, we're going to eat up a lot of this 3:18 that's left.
Absolutely right. They work out of the I formation, spread the field with the slot to the left. Six-man defensive front for the Warriors. And quick hitter up the middle to Braden Powell, and he's dropped for no gain on the play. Right at the line of scrimmage is all the progress he could get.
Big thing there, he held on to the football. That is critical right now. There's 30 seconds on the clock, and we're at 3 minutes, so we can let that roll down.
Just to about 2:30 and snap it from there. Third down.
Third and seven.
Eastmore will get the ball back, but should be less than
unless
2 minutes.
We get a first.
Yes, it should be less than 2 minutes remaining in the game. Irvin.
And remember, folks, they need two scores.
There's the winner. It's a pitch to the left side. And it's...
And now's a chance.
It has the first down.
Eli Broerman with the carry, had a big group of blockers out in front of him, did a fine job there of picking up a first down, and that one can just about solve it now. They're going to have an official, they got players down on the field, so they'll stop the clock at 2:26, but they have no timeouts. We have a first down.
That's Cotton, number three, made that big kickoff return call back, and he's down around the 22-yard line. So 2:26 remaining. First and 10, Jackson at the 27-yard line.
Once again, looks like treating him for cramps.
Bruner and Conte both have had episodes where they've had to have some assistance there on the like for cramps.
Stay tuned. We're not far from picking up that elusive 10th win in a playoff history for the Jackson Ironmen, and we will have a typical post game where we give away awards. Obviously, the Monroe Collision Hit of the Game Award and the Gillum Insurance Player of the Game. Pete Wilson's stats, and it will be very interesting to talk to Coach Hall on this one, providing the Ironmen hold on to this, what looks to be almost a sure victory. Boy, that's the kiss of death, isn't it, when you do that kind of stuff? But it would take a real couple strange events here for the Ironmen not to get a win tonight.
Yeah, it certainly would. And finally, we're the injured player up, and he's going to be assisted off the field, not putting any weight on that one leg.
A gentleman named Greg Potter kind of was involved in that huddle out there. This will be his last game as the equipment director for the Ironmen on Alumni Field. He will be retiring from that position this year, but he's not done. He's still got another week.
Is he done? Thirty-year-or-so career here at Jackson City School. And told me before the game he's going to retire May 28th. He had the date circled.
Well, he came on board back when I was still on the coaching staff and teaching. So that's a long time ago. That's 37 years ago. And he was just that young man out of Oak Hill High School that the Ironmen were wise enough to hire as a teacher and a coach.
Okay, the injured player off the field, and now Jackson ready. The ball at the line of scrimmage.
And the clock's running, and we can let, well, no, wait a second. The head official's going to stop it. It was an injury, so they should start the clock. That's what Coach Hall was signaling to the head official about.
Yeah,
they are going to start it, and we can stand at the line of scrimmage now, let about 24 seconds run off the clock.
And now officials stop it. The timeout. An official's timeout.
Coach Hall wants to get the full time frame back on the 25-second clock. Now they're going to talk things over.
2:14 is what's on the game clock.
You know, we could just about take a knee. I think we can take a knee if we wanted to. Not risk a handoff.
Yes.
A lot of discussion going on.
They want some time added to the game clock. It's going to be 2:23 now, and now the clock will
run. And now they start it. Okay. And we can let 35 seconds run off. It'll be under 2 minutes when we take this snap. As long as we don't turn it over, we can do that three more times.
And that would just about...
We're not far from having our guys start to line up at that 50-yard line for the handshake.
Now clock inside 2 minutes and 13 seconds on the play clock.
Junior quarterback Jacob Winters keeping an eye on that and how he gets his offense ready. They'll snap it with about 2 seconds left.
And he'll pitch it to Roman, right side. Roman cuts
good
back
cut
across
back.
The grain. And it looked like he was going to go. He's finally brought down at the 18-yard line, but that looks like a 9-yard gain, just short of the first down.
How good has Eli Broerman been running the football, Pete, this second half?
Well, he's up to 61 yards now on 12 carries, and I tell you, he's been the stud on this drive. I tell you what, time and again, getting big gains when Eastmore has to have a stop and can't get it.
That was a nice job. That offensive line allowed him to have that space to cut back against Green, put us in a second and very short situation.
1:05 to go in the game.
Now I think we are in the genuflect formation.
Winners looking up the play clock, takes the snap, and now inside a minute, and the Ironman will need to snap it one more time.
Let the celebration begin here at Alumni Stadium. The Jackson Ironmen stay alive, and we'll get to play another week. And it was starting to look like maybe a Mount Orb rematch. I think they had a two-score lead, although in that game there's going to be points scored.
It's the final play of the game as Winters take the snap, and Eastwood cannot stop the clock. And the Jackson Ironmen are going to come away with a 17-6 victory over Eastmore Academy Warriors.
This is the number 2 seed, the Jackson Ironmen, in this Division 3 Region 11 playoff berth there, and the Ironmen keep alive, and we will be the higher seed on regardless of who wins the Mount or the Western Brown Belt Fountain winner. But we'll have to wait till probably Sunday to find out where that contest will be played on a neutral field.
Absolutely. 17-6 is your final as the two teams meet at center field, exchange handshakes, and we'll take a break. We'll be back as the Jackson Ironmen second win in the playoff run here, and.